Hello and welcome to another segment of Ask a Farrinarian. My name is Brian Eidelman, and today I will be talking about parasite management and deworming strategies. This video stems from some questions I get fairly often about do I recommend rotational deworming and do I recommend fecal egg counts. The issue, before I get rambling too far, is more about parasite management than parasite elimination. There will always be parasites. Parasites have parasites. This video is about some of the key points and strategies in the management of parasites here in Colorado. Simply put, twice yearly deworming should be more than sufficient, three times a year at most. Great times are right before grazing season starts, kind of in the late spring, and after it ends in the early fall. And the main reason why is that deworming before grazing season limits the shedding of eggs actually out onto the pasture, and deworming after grazing season allows you to address the parasites they have inevitably picked up while they were grazing. The two most reliable products are ivermectin or moxidectin and Pyrantel. The generics are totally fine. Switching between these two is fine, or if you find that your horse tolerates one better than the other, stick with that one. Ivermectin is about 99% effective, and Pyrantel is usually in the high 90s as well. Every 18 months to 2 years, it's not a bad idea to have to use a product with Praziquantel to address the tapeworms. Horses don't have huge issues with tapeworms, but it's still a good idea to deal with them periodically. Dewormers with Praziquantel will have names like Max or Plus or Gold. Another product on the market is finbendazole or Panacure. Unfortunately, this has become much less effective. It really is only effective as the power pack, and only then to get one insisted phase of one parasite that is resistant to most other dewormers. However, it is very expensive and a large amount of product to ask your horse to tolerate for such a narrow spectrum of effect. The main take-home message for this whole video is that good husbandry, good manure management, and good nutrition are far more critical to long-term effective parasite control than any deworming product out there. Without those three, it'd be like choosing to rely on antibiotics for disease management rather than washing your hands, cooking your food, or using flush toilets. We'll break this whole thing down by starting with how horses actually get parasites. The primary spread is fecal to oral, which simply means poop in the mouth. Internal parasites pass out of the host animal in their manure. Then, while it's outside the host, the eggs mature to the stage in which they are infective to the other animals and hang out and wait to be eaten and start the cycle all over again. I'll address that maturing time here in a second and how that factors into manure management. But for now, fecal balls make nice cozy houses for the eggs. Hot, dry, sunny conditions make the eggs use their reserve capacity faster and therefore die off faster. We're very fortunate in Colorado that we have all three of those conditions, hot, dry, and sunny, for most of the grazing season. The wetter the pasture is, or the more shaded the fecal balls are, the longer the eggs can survive. So why manure management is so important is simply that grazing through manure is the key step for picking up new parasites. Parasite eggs can become infective in as little as 7 to 10 days and stay infective for 6 months or even longer depending on conditions. If an egg that hasn't matured to that infective stage is ingested, it simply passes on through and continues on with its life cycle. This is a large part of why regular and thorough manure removal, at least once weekly, is so key in keeping parasite exposure and worm burden down. If you can get the manure up and out of the way, the eggs never have a chance to infect the next horse. There are any number of feeders designed to keep or limit animals from walking through the hay and defecating in it. Another key point is avoiding overstocking. More animals mean more manure. More manure means more exposure to parasites. Common guideline for how many animals a pasture will support is, can the pasture grow faster than they can eat it down? Another key question that should be asked is there sufficient feed and sufficient space for all the animals? So often the lower animals in the pecking order are forced to graze through contaminated feed or the dirtiest parts of the pasture. Quick thought on manure spreaders. They do have a role. They are cheap, effective methods for manure disposal and for fertilizing pastures. However, they do serve to reseed the pasture with those same parasite eggs. In my experience, they can do a great job of busting up the fecal balls, but just through sheer numbers, a lot of fecal balls do make it back out into the pastures untouched. Nutrition. Good nutrition is important because the immune system is one of the first systems sacrificed by the body when poor nutrition is present. Domesticated animals have developed some inherent resistance and tolerance to parasites, which is again why we talk about parasite management rather than elimination. However, inevitably, the immune system is compromised. Stressful life, travel, exposure to new diseases, pregnancy, poor nutrition, or just sheer numbers of parasite eggs they're exposed to, every animal is susceptible. Good nutrition helps keep the immune system robust and better able to resist the pressure of parasite exposure. From a practical standpoint, a good nutritional plain indicates a large supply of good forage. While it sounds obvious, there are several behavioral observations that are worth noting. Plenty of good forage means that animals can be pickier about what they eat, meaning that they are less likely to graze through manure-contaminated feed when there is clean hay 2 feet away. Lack of good or sufficient forage also means that an animal is forced to graze through poor contaminated feed or pasture. Very often, the animals lower in the pecking order have much higher parasite loads because of these points. Poor hay means a poor nutritional plane. Poor nutritional plane means poor immune system. And then the animal is a poor doer. He's just sick, which means they eat more of the poor quality hay, and the cycle continues. And this puts the healthier animals at further risk. As far as pasture management, pastures do have a tendency to develop what I call sweet spots. Different types of grass, some animals like more than others. Also, there are certain areas of the pastures where horses will tend to congregate and therefore tend to graze more heavily. Why that's important is that grasses respond to being grazed by growing roots deeper and increasing the sugar and nutrition content in the remaining plant and then regrowing. This makes the grazed areas taste better and more likely to be grazed on again, thereby increasing exposure. You can have 10 horses on 100 acres, and they'll primarily graze 2 or 3 of those acres, and the rest they just kind of walk around in. You may have stocking rates well below capacity, but they'll choose on their own to overstock certain areas. I'll talk about fecal egg counts, and this transitions more to my opinion and kind of my experience. I understand the idea behind this as a tool for deciding which animals need deworming and measuring for resistance to those dewormers. In theory, they should be great for these purposes. But, and again, this is my opinion and in my experience, fecal egg counts tend to be unreliable and or poorly done. I have yet to have any owners tell me their previous egg counts have found any parasites. I have personal experience with labs returning fecal egg counts of 0, and then when I checked the samples on my own, the samples loaded with eggs. Because of inconsistent results, I think fecal egg counts in large part give a false sense of security. If I'm going to do a fecal egg count with a proven and reliable lab, the main thing I'm looking for is the count before administration of dewormer and the count afterwards. And I want a significant drop in that count. Lack of drop in the egg count after deworming is a good indicator of resistance. A 0 egg count to me is more an indication of a need to retest and to check test protocol rather than a parasite-free animal. Couple of thoughts to ponder. If you think your animals are at high risk, what can you do to improve that and lower their risk today, tomorrow, next week, next month, next year. If you don't think your animals are at high risk, double check that. Spend a day or two, watch their habits. Make sure they're being fed what and how you expect. Make sure everyone has plenty to eat and isn't forced to graze through poor pasture or suboptimal conditions. These simple management steps and strategies really can improve overall health and well-being for your animals. The key point, use dewormers when needed and as a tool, not as the keystone. Dewormers without good management will only result in you and your horse being messy, covered in dewormer, mad for no actual benefit, and will serve only to speed resistance to dewormers. Thanks for taking a few minutes to watch. If you've got some helpful information out of this, please feel free to share this video. Keep an eye on the Aggie Vet and Farrier Services Facebook page and website for future videos. Thanks so much.